So we're adding that explicitly onto the mind map, saying yes, the structure, function, and energy are characteristics of the body. Now, you know, there is a structure to the spirit, but we're covering that in spirit separately, because it's a structure that is superfluid, so it can move in and out of the biological body.
I thought you had subcategories for all three of those.
I do. Yeah, that's what I'm going to talk about next.
Right, cool.
So yeah. Body, energy, you know, the mind affects energy. Mind is energy. It's a different kind of energy. It's dark energy. The spirit is dark matter in our model. It's a known, documented, proven type of dark energy and dark matter. They're not easily measured by our material, you know, the body material type of, the body makes this other body that's an instrument, a medical or a scientific instrument, laboratory instrument, that's going to measure things that it resonates with, things of its nature, things that are material, whether it's structural, whether it's functional movement patterns, whether it's energetic flow of electricity, magnetism, light. So let's go into structure. So within each of these, of the quintessence, or the trinity, we have the trinity of body, mind, spirit, and then within body, we've got the sub-trinity of structure, function, and energy. It's another way to look at it. So within each of these areas, body, mind, spirit, structure, function, energy, we're going to... I have a model of how we can think about things, how to break down our thinking on a particular topic. The topic I'll call a container, an idea. We're going to talk about the body structure. Okay, that's our container. I'm talking about that. But the container is within this overall model. That's the context. The context is structure of the body in the clinical theory of everything. Okay? So the context, we have it in context, and we have a container of the body structure. And then within that container, we have also content, the sub-containers within that, or the content. So that's how we're going to break it down. We're going to be explicit about the context, because it's not just the context of the model, it's the context of the body in the real world. Oh, it's important. We're in this cosmos. We're on the planet Earth, we're under the sun, the Earth is spinning around, so sometimes we're in the lit environment and sometimes we're in the dark, and that's a huge difference electromagnetically in terms of the energy. So now the context of the body, and now I'm talking about energy. So again, these aren't separate things. Like, historically, we have a problem with separating things and thinking that they're really separate. Like, oh, well, you're a dentist and I'm an eye doctor, so what I do to the teeth doesn't have anything to do with affecting the eye disease or whatever. Like,
or the hearing,
you know, the ear, nose, throat specialist, that's different from the dentist, so there's no connection there. Everything is connected, like John Muir said, if you tug on anything in nature, you find it's connected to everything else. It's why we call it a universe. It's not a collection verse. It's not a collection of separate parts. It's an integral whole in itself and how everything is all tied in. So the context of our body is contextual in the model that we're talking about the body, and it relates to function, it relates to energy, it relates to the thinking and the spirit. So yeah, those contexts. And also just in space and time. What's the context of where is this body? And so if we're on the dark side of the planet, we have a low energy field. If we're on the sun solar side, we have a high environmental energy field. And so we have a diurnal rhythm, a daily cycle of light and dark, mediated by the pineal gland, melatonin. In humans, through light through the eyes, where in other organisms it's through light directly on the pineal. Our pineal is doing something else. It's not on the surface of the body like other animals where it can receive environmental light. it still gets a signal about the light, but it's whatever it's receiving. It has a retina, it has a lens, it's an optical organ. So there's this whole question of why is it in the middle of our head? And why on autopsy is it pointing either up or down? That's a structural difference. Is there a functional difference? Why is there no research? There's no money for that. It's not a drug issue. It's not a surgical issue. Not important. Yes?
Can it point in any other directions the rest of the time?
Not that I've read. I don't know.
Does it point forward ever or back?
It points up or down.
It always points up or down.
So it's I see it as a cosmological
orientation.
It's either orienting to the dark, to gravity, away from the cosmos and the light, or up toward the heavens. And my proposal, my theory is what it's orienting to in the upward direction is not the sun. Again, if it was orienting to sunlight, it would be like in other animals. It would be at the top of the skull with a little opening, and there'd be light coming in. I believe there's evidence, and there needs to be further research, but to me, all the evidence points to our theory, in clinical theory, that the pineal is orienting to the galactic center. I don't say that lightly, I don't say that just flippantly. It's the research on psychic communication between subjects. In other words, the ability of your mind to connect meaningfully with my mind, not through vision, hearing, or other means of communication. there's a huge number of studies that have been done with using the same protocol, and so they can all be combined into one meta study. And because these people were at different places on the planet, they can be compared as far as time of day. And they found there's a curve with the time of day. There's an effect of the time of day. And they found that when they plotted that time of day, not by where the sun is, but by where the galactic center is in the sky, which we can't even see, right? Daytime, can't see it. You know, we're not something we're consciously aware of. But when they plot where the galactic center is in the sky, when we're trying to do the psychic communication between human beings, when the galactic center is at sidereal noon, at its highest peak in the sky, closest to where the pineal would be pointed if it's aimed up, then there is no, statistically, no communication going on. It's wiped out. By what? How about some other communication? How about we are receiving communication from the galactic center? See, I am absolutely perfect evidence that the universe is conscious. We're not separate from the universe, we're part of it. It's a conscious universe. Even if we were the only conscious part, it's a conscious universe. I guarantee you, we are not the only conscious part. Every part has its form of consciousness. We look for consciousness as if it was only for human consciousness. How conscious is magnesium of how to be magnesium? Does it forget? Never. It's perfect. It's angelic consciousness. So we're just looking for human consciousness. We look at animals and say, are they conscious? Of course they are. They're not zombie robots like we become when we take Tylenol, according to recent research. Not only Tylenol, steroids and psychotropic drugs. So if the human pineal gland is receiving meaningful communication, meaningful signals, meaningful enough that it overpowers our ability to communicate with each other on that same frequency, that same wavelength through the pineal, when our antenna is pointed closest to the source, when it's at sidereal noon, well, that's pretty darn interesting. And again, it's a unique anatomy, a unique structure in human beings. we have our pineal in the middle of our skull. So by the time the cranial sutures close in childhood, early childhood, we're not receiving any environmental light signals to that pineal. There is a roundabout pathway that leaves the skull into the neck, through the sympathetic nervous system, back into the head, to tell the pineal when it's day and night based on light through the eyes. Why would we develop that pathway? Why would we develop that position of the pineal? Whether we had help and its genetic engineering from other intelligent species, I mean, we can theorize, and maybe we can find evidence of one or the other. We do have about 5% of our DNA is ALU, ALU DNA. It's very rare. There's a few other species, all primates like us, that have less than 5%. We have 5%. 5% doesn't sound like a lot. Well, how much of your DNA codes for the biological body structure, all the proteins, enzymes? About 5%. So we have as much DNA of this ALU DNA that's not from... We have more than any other species on Earth. There's only a couple other species that have any. We have as much as what codes for our biological body on Earth, as much of the ALU DNA. And it's DNA that its function is to assist the DNA in reprogramming itself within our lifetime. In other words, your DNA is not static. Your genetic code changes, just like Lamarck proposed. He was right. It is true. It's not the only way it changes. Radiation effects on the DNA that creates breaks and changes and damage, and that can be inheritable. And theoretically, I mean, it's never been proven, but theoretically you could have a random change like that that is inheritable, that's beneficial. And that's the theory of evolution. That's our conventional theory. But we now know that your DNA can also change within your lifetime, according to the Lamarckian idea that the giraffe is reaching, it's stretching its neck, it's creating that field, and the DNA in every cell is responding to the field. That's, we call it now epigenetics. 10 years ago, nobody was talking about it except the homeopaths, and they called it miasms. And everybody else said, miasm. They used to think that something was inheritable that's not hardwired genetic. Those fools. Oh, now they own it. Now it's, oh yeah, this is real science. We still don't talk about the homeopaths, but... But they have 200 years of observation in the real world, in the clinic floor, watching. And I've seen cases where treat somebody with homeopathy, clear their miasm, and suddenly their mom, who they haven't talked to in 10 years, calls them out of the blue to say, guess what, honey? You know that problem I've always had? It just went away. Because when you treat the miasm doesn't exist in the individual, it exists in the universe of individuals with that resonance. And so within the family pattern, you have the same DNA antenna as your mom. You have half of hers, she has half of yours, that's enough. And across thousands of miles, there's biocommunication happening without conscious intent. So imagine what we can do with conscious intent. We can double the effect, yes, of any medicine with conscious intent, especially if it's the right medicine, if it's producing a coherent state. You know, coherence is one of the key principles to understand. It's the whole essence of what we strive for in order to produce what we call accelerated self-healing. Why does healing go faster in our program? Because we look for what creates greater coherence in your body, in your mind, in your spirit. We can measure the body. You can observe the mind. We can get clues of that talking with you. And the spirit responds to the mind and the body. So we create the coherence in the mind and the body. The spirit responds. We now know in our model what the spirit is made of, so we can supply the building blocks, the structural elements. We can supply the energetic blueprints for growth and development of it. That's what we call the Holy Grail formulas. And can do all that on an individual basis. And it's not just individual, here's your genetic code. And again, your genetic code is not static, it's changing. Certainly the expression of it, we've known for a long time, is changeable. But also the actual code, the Alu DNA, reprograms it within your lifetime, and that is transmissible to the next generation. So humans, for all appearances, the best interpretation we have for Alu DNA is that it's alien DNA. It did not come from, there's no evidence that it came from earthly evolution processes. It came from some other planet, came from some other life form with the same type of genetic code, same sequencing, you know, but a whole different pattern of structure and function and energy. So it gets pretty interesting when you really open your mind to ask the big questions. You know, who we are, where we're going, are we cosmic citizens? Is this, as saints of centuries past have called it, the womb of heaven? Is that real? Is it more than just a nice spiritual idea? Is there truth to our immortality? As the laboratory studies show, you can take an image of the DNA, which of course would be carried by the spirit body in the case of our being, but in the laboratory we can create an image, a holographic image of DNA. We can remove that DNA sequence. We can then create the holographic image again with the same lasers and the glassware, the quartz or the glass that image was formed in, and put in the structural building blocks of DNA, and it will reform the exact sequence of DNA. What that means is your spirit body is scientifically supported theory that your spirit body can reconstitute your exact DNA. And if it does that, and out of that DNA, it also reconstitutes your biological vessel, it means you can resurrect your body in perfect health. You know, it won't have scars of damage from this life because it's resurrected. There's also some limited evidence historically that you can transcend with your body intact and keep the scars, keep your tattoos. You won't have the tattoos, sorry. You'll have to do those again. So there are a couple of Old Testament saints that were taken up in whirlwinds. And the tradition has it that they are still as alive or more alive than you and me, but with the original bodies. Christ's mother Mary, her body was taken up, separate from her spirit, but put back together in heaven. So she's also got her original body. So we can either take our bodies with us, or we can regenerate our bodies. It's not saying this is, you know, easy. You can do it 100% guaranteed, or your money back. It's possible. If these things are in the realm of possibility, certainly there've been many people who were resurrected even from bones that were hundreds of years old and dead in the grave. Flesh came back on. So we really have no idea what's impossible as far as healing. I've seen things heal that the textbooks say don't happen. They're, you know, oh, that's impossible. That's an irreversible cause of blindness. I've seen it in multiple different types of irreversible blindness. So the key, I think, is this concept of coherence zones, where when you have a coherence zone, it means it's a cellularity, it's a cell, it's a space within which everything is working together as a waveform. The wave can do things that the separate particles all working against each other can't do. You know, two particles can't be in the same space at the same time, can they? Okay, no, you can't do that. No, can't go there. When as soon as it's a coherence zone, it's all in waveform, it's acting as one. It's a unification of the whole process. The characteristics of function, of energy, of structure change. Structure can dissolve. What is, I've experienced and have seen when I was, my first office was in Tokyo, Japan, went with people from the company, including the wife of the vice president of the company who had a large ovarian cyst. Filipino healer, did psychic surgery. Interpenetration of the structure of his body and her body, or in mine, I experienced it on myself, and medically documented that that cyst that was there the day before was not there like after the weekend when she had it tested again. So sometimes our conception of what's possible is our biggest limiting stumbling block. Limiting factor, the barrier to achieve the results that maybe we don't even consider possible. If we don't consider it possible, we will not produce that result as a placebo effect, and that's half of the result of getting that result if we had the right medicine that could do it on its own, half the potential for healing. So that's why the theory is important. It actually helps make the healing twice as effective, and in the case of opening our mind to what's possible, makes it possible at all. If you believe, you know, oh, I'm on this thyroid medication, so I'll need it for the rest of my life because my thyroid doesn't make enough hormone. It's like, wait a minute, let's question that. Is that really true? Thyroid is a glandular tissue. All glandular tissues have the capacity to regenerate. When I went to school to be a doctor, we learned that brain tissue doesn't regenerate. Well, now we know it does. Right? So back then, what would we have tried to regenerate brain tissue? Oh, no, it doesn't do that, so we're not going to study that. We don't believe it can happen. Are we going to fund that? Are we going to fund it with our time and energy to explore? There's so much exploratory research that has not been done that doesn't even require a bunch of money. It takes intention, takes thought, takes awareness, takes a little bit of resources. But we're working with nature. Nature's not that expensive. It's actually already made. The medicines we need are here. We need to develop the awareness and the sensitivity and the systems to be able to sense them, to communicate with them, to communicate with the body, to sense when the body is responding to those medicines, to sense what form, what dosage, what frequency, what quality is necessary. And then I don't know anymore what's not possible to achieve. Who am I to say you can't heal that?
So what would you tell one of your students or apprentice, whatever you want to call them, who is working on this specific thing as far as opening the mind to unlimited possibilities? Do you have a suggestion about how to get from A to B, A being I don't believe it's possible, to B, I do believe it's possible?
One of my favorite thoughts for myself is like a little prayer to my spirit vessel, which has this mineral substrate basis that's super fluid, super conducting, so it's ghost-like. It's the ghost. It's the ghost in the machine. It's the part that's actually seeing, that's hearing me, that has meaningfulness, experiences meaning, that's directing the action, that makes the choice, the choices, the decisions, that has the free will to act. So that conscious part, which is the function of that ghost vessel, can communicate to the ghost vessel itself, which by nature is the substrate, the antenna, the transceiver, the antenna, the sender-receiver unit for consciousness within the vessel and between the vessel and the body and between the vessel and the world. So, and it responds to phonons, to sound, to thought, whether you voice it or you just think it. If you think or you say, okay, spirit minerals, however I want to call you, spirit gold, M-state gold, Ormus, philosopher's stone, white powder gold, however I know you, by whatever name, divine presence in the form of atoms that join together in sheet, in two-dimensional sheets of lattice structure that's fluid, superfluid, that can float in and out of the body, that can take up its space in the cell membrane as a two-dimensional consciousness of the cell, whether that's a nerve cell or whether it's any cell, has consciousness of its type, and the nerve cells get together and communicate their level of consciousness to our whole spirit level that we're aware of as a spirit vessel. But there's certainly subconscious processing in every cell. So, so okay, guys, you're just waiting for me to tell you what to do. I haven't been talking to you. I'm sorry. And you guys are like 5/9 present here now, but 4/9 is non-local in space-time. So you can be anywhere or anytime. So I'm going to instruct you right now to go there, all those places I've been and all those places I will be, and all those times in the past and future, past me, future me, or any influences, places and times that had some bearing on this vessel here now that you're part of, and make the correction. Say the prayer. Give the instructions. Let my word be truth. Let it be so according to my word. I am the king of this little portable real estate, this little vessel here, this little spirit navigational entity that can navigate the heavens when it leaves here. And I'm here to serve. I'm here as part of the whole. I'm here as a live cell, as a viable cell in the whole of the divine source, of which everything I can see is an image. I create this image of the world I see, project it into the world, and help me create coherence. Help me be true to what is. Help me serve the greater good, the greater need. Help me make the universe a better place for me to live in, by making a better place for all the other cells around me.
Thank you.
And even saying that once, because that ghost transcends time, and our thoughts can transcend time. We can instruct it to have effects on the past, on the future. Time is not a linear downhill slide, as it's seen in physics, modern physics. Well, it's the heat death of the universe, everything's just going to fall apart and get, you know, go to unusable energy, and everything will just be kind of all spread apart and won't be anything anymore at the end. It's a very uninspiring view. But we take a view that for every action, there is a reaction. For every increase in entropy in that downhill slide, there's an increase in syntropy, is its counterpart, of life, of consciousness, of increased spirit. That the universe exists in order for that spirit to grow. And the increase in entropy that we see in the physical is just the essential side counterpart. You know, that's the fuel that makes that happen. It's great. It's a good thing. It's fine. Perfect.
Exciting.
Yeah.
So we can make ourselves believe anything is possible, pretty much.
Yeah, but belief
is... And what we've known from the studies is that, like you said, who's to know what is possible anyways? Who's to know what is not possible?
Can I prove that something's not possible? Ever? No? Because it might be possible and I just haven't found a way. I can never prove that something is impossible, ever. I can never prove that a theory is true, ever. I can find it useful. I can document that it's useful and the range of conditions under which it's useful. Now, if there's something that's true that I don't believe is true, and therefore I'm not considering those conditions, like spirit and consciousness and immortality and a live universe, an interactive, vibrant universe, but I'm just keeping myself inside the box, and I have this model that explains everything in the box, and if I say, oh, parapsychology, no, that's outside the box, doesn't exist, even though there's great evidence to support it. Future affecting the past, oh, no, it doesn't exist, even though, even inside the box, there's evidence for it. If we go to quantum level, oh, but that's quantum weirdness, okay, doesn't apply at the human scale. Yeah, it does. Recent studies showing slide presentations, the heart responds before the slide is shown as far as the emotional content in that slide. Before the computer determines which slide is shown, the heart responds. Heart responds before the brain does. There's more signals going from the heart to the brain than from the brain to the heart. So, you know, consciousness isn't all about the zombie brain that thinks it's a zombie. The brain that thinks it's a zombie is going to be a zombie. It's going to act as a zombie. Will that spirit vessel be able to resurrect the body? I don't know. If our mind is that powerful, maybe not. Maybe they'll come back anyway and say, whew, good thing. I wasn't right. But literally, over 90% of like PhDs in brain science and biology believe that the human being, I mean, they don't apply it to themselves directly, you know, usually linguistically, but that the human being is a philosophical zombie. Consciousness is an illusion. If it's an illusion, how come we can measure quantum effects at that remote site where I visualize healing happening? We're alive. That in itself is exciting news. That there is a spirit that transcends the physical body. It's like, wow, so life matters because I'm building that. That's my spaceship. I don't know if I can continue building it after I leave my biological body. Maybe if I regenerate the physical body, I suppose I can. And that's hopeful too for the afterlife. It's like, wow, there's more. We don't even know. But the fact that my choices here, it's not whether I... You know, it's not whether I get rid of the pain that matters, it's how I relate, how I interface with pain, my pain. I can tell my spirit, you know, without even thinking of the structural model of it, and say, I'm going to send my consciousness to the pain. I'm going to feel the pain. You know, by feeling pain, pain usually will diminish. Often by a tremendous amount. I can send my consciousness to the pain and surround it and beyond. I love sending it beyond the pain. Oh, when I surround the pain with consciousness, well, if the consciousness is automatically bringing those spirit minerals with it, and that's how it works, like we say in the model, then that means it's bringing superconductivity. And if we surround... In Oriental medicine, pain is understood as a blockage of energy flow. So if I have a conductor, a plasma, like the extracellular fluid, the nerves, the blood vessels, the blood plasma, it's conducting energy, and now there's a blockage in that energy flow, but I bring in a superconductor and surround it, now the energy can flow through the superconductor and bypass the blockage, and the pain reduces. It's so simple. But, you know, it's not if we don't even believe there's something more than a possibility of taking something to kill the pain. Kill the pain! What is that pain? Is that pain coming from, is that a signal? Is it a meaningful, does it mean something? There's something happening, there's a reason for it. So is it a meaningful signal from part of me? Do I want to kill that signal? What am I doing to me if I'm killing the signal? I'm killing the ability to send the signal? Or am I really healing the reason for the signal? So a crucial concept is to understand that a symptom can go away with either healing or with another layer of disease, with suppression, we call it. I can suppress the symptom. Symptom went away. You know what's going to happen? If I'm healthy enough, it's going to come back. Studies on aspirin and headaches clearly showed that. You have a headache, take an aspirin. Headache goes down. What happens the next day? You're more likely to get a headache than if you hadn't taken the aspirin. Why? Because it's stopping the healing process. So now the thing that was causing the headache is still there along with the aspirin. And the next day, if you have enough energy, you're going to start dissolving that and bringing out the reason for the headache, which is to eliminate something. So we never have a deficiency of aspirin, but we do have an excess of something that doesn't belong there that we're trying to get out, and that's a headache, the cause of the headache. So we have deficiencies of nutrients, we have deficiencies of energy, of good energy, electrons. We have a deficiency of electrons. Electrons are the ultimate antioxidant, because an antioxidant is defined as an electron donor. Well, what better to donate an electron than a free electron? Here I am. You want a donation? I'm it, right? Where do we get electrons? Well, in healthy air, we breathe them in from moving water and plants and a natural environment. There's lots of negative ions in the air. That's a negative charge. That's an extra electron in that ion. We get them from the earth. The earth is negatively charged. The sun is positively charged. There's an electrical circuit, and we're living on the fractal electron, except when we wear our Nikes and ride in the car. Now we have rubber boots, rubber soles on. Now we're no longer getting the electrons we need from the earth. Now we need them from antioxidant supplements, vitamin C, vitamin E, vitamin A. Those are antioxidants, but we call them vitamins because they have a life-giving organic mineral function as a cofactor as a coenzyme. So if we use up our vitamin C as an antioxidant, we don't have it for its coenzyme functions and other functions. So better that we connect with nature, with the environment, replete our nature deficiency, go walk on the organic grass with the dew. Go walk on the beach where there's a little, where the seawater is holding the sand together, so it's damp, and we're connected. Or take a shower and put a little Epsom salts in the water, plug the tub, take a shower with our feet in Epsom salts, take a bath in Epsom salts. We'll also absorb the magnesium from that through the skin. It's the most deficient mineral, so it's a good thing to do. You can use sea salt too, but Epsom salts are great because we need magnesium. Yeah.